provides direction on educational and networking opportunities geared towards small brokers and small business owners. Forum sessions, designated by the Small Broker Forum Advisory Team, offer an informal setting that allows for an open exchange of ideas on relevant topics. With that being said, we are proud to present Property Management 101, the do's and don'ts of getting started. I'm happy to introduce our speaker for this morning, John Mel Testa, a property management of Fairfax. John is a small business owner, Army veteran, entrepreneur, and family man who hopes to share his knowledge of property management with you today. John, without further ado, take it away.
Thank you very much, Debbie. Pleasure to be here. I see we're filling up nicely, so I am going to go ahead and get the presentation started, and everybody should be able to see my screen now, I hope, yes. And it should say Property Management 101, maybe a little more too. So with that being said, let's go ahead and get started. A little bit about who we are. As Debbie said, I am the owner of PMI of Fairfax. We manage a little over $60 million of real estate in Northern Virginia. I've been doing this for quite a while. We've been doing property management since about 2013 for our clients. I've been in real estate since 06, investor, landlord, renovator, doing a little bit of everything. I'm an Army vet, had over 13 years in the services. I'm an entrepreneur, avid reader, like Debbie said, family man, and I absolutely just love to help everybody. So that's what I'm kind of doing here today. Hopefully we can help you guys. That being said, here's our plan. What we wanted to do is go over a little bit about renting homes in our area, some do's and don'ts, differences between service animals and pets, some of the best practices for renting homes, and also finding property management companies for your clients. What are some specific differences between the agent duties and property management duties? And then, of course, open the floor to questions. So let's dive right into our first subject here, renting in the Northern Virginia area. What I've always said is, I gotta love it. In Fairfax alone, we have over 15,000 homes that are non-owner occupied. A lot of them will be second homes, vacation homes, but the vast majority of them are gonna be rentals in the area. The average yearly income for a family in Fairfax is a little over $61,000. We have great homes. The average rent in Fairfax is also over $1,900 a month, so in a lot of cases, you're able to cover your mortgage. We have great tenants in the Northern Virginia area. The vast majority of people in the Northern Virginia area are transient. They're not native to Northern Virginia. I am one of them. I moved here about 10 years ago. So we also have great landlords. They do want to take care of the homes. They do want to provide a great place to live for their tenants. So it's a really good piece of business, a key to your business that I think you should add. Okay. So some simple do's and don'ts. Now these might sound simple, but they're very important. Follow fair housing all the times. Little simple questions can lead to big issues. One of the questions that we have seen that can get some people in a little bit of trouble is, how many kids do they have? This is a fairly simple, benign question on the surface, but it does touch on to some fair housing issues such as family configuration. You want to avoid that. You don't want to necessarily get into that situation. Another simple question, can I see their application or credit report? Application, absolutely. However, the full credit report, sometimes according to credit bureau rules, are not allowed to be seen by everybody. So just be aware of the do's and don'ts there. Provide the same screening for every app. Might sound redundant, but a lot of people don't do it, and it leads to problems because then you're not treating everybody equally. Treating everyone equally equalizes everything. Like I said, it just keeps you out of that gray area. Don't overpromise to landlords. Don't promise there won't be an eviction. Very rare. It is low in our area, but it still happens. We've helped several landlords who, unfortunately, for whatever reason, needed to remove a tenant. It does happen in Northern Virginia. Don't necessarily believe an applicant's sob story. Listen, be attentive, but know that they have to fit in the box that you established for your credit and application rules. Again, everybody equal. Pets versus service animals. So are two different things. A service animal is not a pet and cannot be treated like one. So no deposits, there's no rent that can be achieved for pet rent. There's also other things you can't do at the end as far as requirements, as far as cleaning. Know what questions you can ask about the need for a service animal. You can't ask specifically about the disability, but you can ask about the need. You can also request documentation on the service animal. They should readily give and expect to give. Those are important. Know the difference. Simple rule of thumb that we've been able to really get our landlords to really understand a service animal and a pet. Service animal, think of it as a wheelchair. Cool, it's an extra piece of equipment tenants are going to bring in to live their lives better. Simple as that. And a lot of times, a little bit more personal, a lot of times these service animals are better trained than almost any other animal that there is. So in many cases, they won't even use the restroom out of command. They have to be let out, the command has to be given, they will then go to the restroom. So sometimes these animals are so well trained, they're really not going to be a problem for the owner and for the property. So some best practices that you should do and look for as an agent. Treat a rental listing like you would a sale listing or a buyer listing. It is just as much work for far less. It's still very, very important because you're doing the right thing and you're servicing the client well. Create a tenant client. It might become a buyer client because they might. We've had many of our tenants buy. It happens all the time. So that's a big key of part of business that can definitely lead to more business. What you should look for in a property management company is some things that the property manager should be devoted to management, not else. That company, this is what they should do. Property managers should also have the resources to protect the landlords and make sure they have good vendors. So the property manager should be properly licensed and insured. The vendor should be properly licensed and insured. The property management company should be properly capitalized, meaning that they can fund their business and take care of things for their clients. They should do regular statements, whether it's monthly or quarterly, always yearly, because there are certain tax forms that need to go out. The property management company should do regular inspections. That's going to be between the property management company and the owner, what that will look like. Regular inspections are very important. Also, one personal note, property managers should try not to nickel and dime their owners, meaning that every little thing that they do, it is a fee-based business, but they also are in a service base. So look for them that are going to take care of their client and not necessarily try to nickel and dime. Agent versus property manager, or property manager versus agent, whichever way you want to look at it. Agents should buy or sell with clients, and rent occasionally for owners. But what that leads to is being a master of your craft, meaning if you're going to be a sales agent, be a sales agent. Know the ins and outs. Have your team built for that. If you're going to be a buyer agent, be a buyer agent. Have your team built for that. Do want to dive into the world of property management. Devote the time and resources to it. There's software, there's education, there's licensing, there's insurances, there's even background. Takes a little bit of time and resources, but devote that and you'll be 100% on your way to being a good property manager. We suggest partnering with a property management company or two just to have a better tool in your tool bag to service your clients. And know that agents and property managements are very different endeavors. So know the difference and choose your path wisely, as they say. Little note, I always love quotes. Look really closely, most overnight success took a long time. So that's Steve Jobs. It's a good quote, and know that it's not going to be an overnight thing as an agent or as a property manager. It is well worth it. With that, we're going to open some questions, and we actually did have three questions submitted before the presentation, so I wanted to start with those. The first question was, what resources are available to know the customary monthly property management charges for condos and small homes or large homes and so forth. So that is going to really be property management company dependent. Every fee is different. The fee structures of all property management companies are a little bit different. And just our due diligence, knowing the area, we've seen a range of about 7 to 12%. But again, it's going to be very different on everybody. So if you have a question about a specific fee that a property manager might charge, I'll just give them a call. And then they can definitely answer that directly. The other thing to know is that commercial and association management is usually done as far as a fee per month, not related to rent rolls or anything like that. Second question we had submitted was, can you provide a list of resources for general and commercial property management? Unfortunately, there's no real great list of general resources. Again, it's going to be property management company specific. But if you're looking for like a lease for a residential, the NVAR website has a bunch of them. And the two main ones are, of course, the common law and the VRLTA. We recommend those. You owner can write their own lease, but we don't recommend it. Doing a lease on a commercial, every lease in the commercial is different. You're just going to have to go into that on a case-by-case basis. The next question is a little bit of a multi-tier question. So it starts off, if the tenant doesn't complete their move-out requirement and the property manager slash landlord is required to handle certain items, A, can the manager charge? Yes. It would be the same as if there was just a contractor that went out and charged the time. So a property manager can charge the tenant for time and repairs if they are specifically the ones doing that repair. And that can be removed from the security deposit. But it's best practice always to hire. This next part is, besides line items, does the property manager landlord need to supply actual receipts to the tenant? Yes, you do give a breakdown to the tenant. You do withhold from security deposit. You need to give a proper receipt or invoice. It's going to cover everything. You need to provide receipts. The next part is, the lease does not require us to use a licensed professional to do repairs, but it does require the tenant to do so. If asked, would it be a requirement that we do, if the tenant asks us to hire a professional, is that important or is that a requirement? No. We don't technically have to hire, landlord does not technically have to hire a professional, because it has to be done, the work has to be done to the satisfaction of the landlord. But if, as a property manager or as a landlord, you're doing work that is, say, damage to the unit after the tenant has moved out, I would say always hire a professional. It's just going to be best practice. I wouldn't try to cut costs and save money here and there by hiring a non-licensed. And that actually goes into the next question. Is it a good idea to, with the acceptance of the landlord, use a non-licensed professional? Yes, they technically can, but again, it goes against that. Also, you run risk of, the landlord runs a risk of, if the work is done properly, there's repercussions that could happen down the road. Hiring a licensed, bonded, and insured working professional, 100% do it. The last part of this question was, do you have any suggestions to make a move out go a little more smoothly? Sometimes there's going to be headaches, there's going to be questions or disagreements about damage. But if you're upfront and you tell that tenant what's going on in the very beginning, I think that's how to handle things. Usually that goes smoothest. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing and open it up to questions, which seem to have a few. Same rules for emotional support animals. Yes, as long as there's documentation from a doctor, yes, the same rules. Emotional support animals again, emotional support animals again, and emotional support animals again. So we have four questions on emotional support. Yes, They do count as service animals. They will have documentation from the doctor that this animal is needed. And you can request that documentation. How often do interior inspections and drive-bys? So drive-bys, you can do whatever you want. No real time frame on those. Interior, we like to get in at least twice a year personally. There's a chance to look at it and go from there. But again, it's going to depend upon the owner and the property manager. If it's yearly, if it's bi-yearly, whatever that is. Another question, are PMs regulated with DPOR? Property management is not considered a licensee activity. So no, they're not. But agent activities are, and we do have a code of ethics as an agent, as a realtor, that does dive into property management. There is a little bit of coverage there as an agent if you're doing property management. All right, Miss Debbie, if you've got any other questions that I didn't see, I am happy to answer.
Well, let's see. There's a question and answer over here. Emotional support. You have that. I have that. How often do you do an interior inspection and a drive-by?
Okay. Another one popped up from Cynthia. During the bi-yearly inspections, the property manager takes pictures of every room, or is that intrusive? It's not too intrusive to take photos, general photos. You don't necessarily have to get every little nook and cranny in detail, but if you take a picture of each room, that's not too intrusive. If the tenant asks you not to, it's as long as you've seen the roof. That's the important part. Things to really look for are water, cleanliness, the lease clauses are being abided by as far as like cleaning and maintenance of the home and things like that. Other thing is, if there was no pets and there's a dog bowl, maybe you want to ask that question then. You're just taking a look at the property to make sure things are in good working order. We got another question, Eva. How about the deductible copay for repair? Is that a good practice? We have seen landlords do a copay or deductible to the tenants for any repairs. A lot of times they have like a home warranty and say a $50, and they put that as their deductible. That's acceptable. We don't recommend it because what that tends to do is stack maintenance requests. We'd rather know as soon as there's a problem of the problem so that we can address it and answer it right away. So the deductible or copay will kind of put tenants off and they could stack their maintenance. Jorge asked, how do you handle hoarding cases in condo rentals? Really good question. Hoarding is becoming under the DS5, what they're considering an illness. So it will, I believe it is actually now a protected illness. So it has to be handled very carefully. And if it does start to present safety and health concern to the condo or structural issue, if the hoarding has become too much and the structure can't handle it, there are certain avenues of reproach for that. But it is becoming a classified as an illness and a protected illness. So you got to be very careful. I would call the legal hotline from NVAR on that one and really delve into that with those attorneys. That's what they're there for, and it's a really good resource that you should use. David, how can I be sure an emotional support letter is for the same animal? Emotional support letters have a time limit? Do they need to be renewed or biannually or anything? No, they don't need to be renewed. They don't really have a time limit. I guess in theory, if the emotional support no longer needed, then maybe that animal would no longer be needed. But how do you know it's for that same animal? It should have some sort of identification on it, a name, a possible picture. The animal, that's probably the best way you can confirm for the animal. Tom, what does what's been discussed also apply to commercial management? Yes, in a lot of ways, commercial management is very similar. Commercial management is different in the sense that the lease is going to be different in every single commercial management property. And the lease really is what governs the relationship between a manager and a tenant and a landlord and a tenant. So since that's going to be different, it's not going to be like your standard common law or VRLTA lease. You have to know what's in that commercial lease and what is the requirements of the landlord slash manager and of the tenant. So it's very similar, little tweaks. Is asking for a pet acceptable? Yes. If it's a pet, yeah, you can do an additional security deposit. You can do a pet rent. You can do a non-refundable security deposit. That's going to be situational dependent on the landlord. But best practice would be to establish a rule up front and go from there. And how much, as far as your question, it's completely up to you. Whatever you would like to do as far as fee goes or the landlord would go, would do is really up to them. But have that rule up front, keep it the same across the board. And then that way you're covered in that sense. Getting a lot of questions. This is good. Please describe a business model for property management owner, percentage of rent, percentage value of property, or set aside in all in management, each door, etc. So there are a few different models. There are percentage models. There are fee-based models. Those are going to be how to best describe it. Every property management company is different. So some are fee-based. Some are percentage of rent. Some are straight fee. Others are, if we do X, we charge Y. It really depends on if you're thinking about starting a property management, sitting down at all of those different ways of charging and fees, figure out which one will work best for you. There's no real winner, if you will, as far as like what's the best way to go. Again, open, honest, upfront. Here's our structure, Mr. and Mrs. Client. Do you like it? Go forward. There's really the best way to do it. So it's however you want to structure your business. Jorge asks, do you foresee any legal problems with property managers due to COVID? Maybe. That'll be my little CYA. So the CARES Act does not allow for evictions until July 25th of 2020. The CARES Act protection ends. I don't see any direct legal issues with it, but it could impact their business because tenants not paying and them not being able to evict and enforce the lease appropriately. In our management contract, we have the ability to do it, but it's an option, it's not a requirement if a tenant violates a lease term. That gives us a little bit of CYA on our end, and we're covered with COVID in this sort of non-eviction clause. And I don't see any real direct legal repercussions that a property manager can entail. COVID. We have pulled back our regular inspections. But other than that, that's an acceptable understanding, I think, given the circumstances. We haven't stopped repairs. Repairs are still required. Our vendors have taken the necessary precautions. I don't see any bleed through in that sense either. Again, that's a really good question. I mean, that's a really good question for the NVAR hotline as well, too. Another question. Do you need a business license for property management as an agent, but not as an owner? So you do not need anything extra as a property manager, but on listed as a business entity as a property manager, you do need a few other no direct property management license in Virginia. Our accreditations, I recommend them. are different states that require different things, but we're just talking about. Is it permissible to advertise no pets or no smoking? Yes. Perfectly fine to say no pets, no smoking. No pets does eliminate 47% of the population, though. Be aware of that. And best practice that we've done is pets case by case. A lot of times people will come and say, I have a fish, I have a bird, I have a gerbil that stays in the cage. We're not worried about those sort of animals. Mainly cats, dogs, and anything that can do damage to the home is what would be the concern for a landlord. So if you say pets case by case, it's not going to immediately eliminate them. Allow them to ask that question. Hey, is my bird okay? Yes, your bird's okay. Deposit, pet rent. No smoking. Again, you can say no smoking. I don't personally smoke for that reason. Frank asked, what is a typical day like for a property manager? What activities do all day long, and can you describe in detail? I could spend about 6 hours in detail, but in general, I'll give you a quick breakdown. In general, we start off with banking. We make sure all the rents have been paid, all the disbursements have been paid, all of our vendors have been paid. That's the very first thing we do in the day. And then we go on to any other maintenance requests that come in, any other coordinations that might have come in, and then it kind of goes on to trying to get new business, talking with potential new clients, meeting with agents, and things of that nature. So really taking care of the very important stuff first, then moving on to less important things. Well, I won't call them less important things. Big rocks first, then small rocks. That's the important thing to do. Dennis, answer on business model. Wasn't what I saw. May I call you? Yeah, Dennis, you can feel free to give me a call, give me an email. It's perfectly fine. Again, you know, we don't want to talk necessarily about the exact feature for many reasons, but happy to take a call, happy to take an email from anybody. Definitely feel free to give me a call or an email. Frank, is property management something you do part-time versus full-time? No, this is full-time. This is 100% what we do for our clients. We don't do sales. Like I said, we really don't focus on sales. We refer those out. We lease homes and we manage homes. That's all we do. Before it's done. Anna asked, how can we handle these two situations? Multiple unrelated applicants. So if you get an application with multiple unrelated applicants, our best course of action is to screen both of them thoroughly, make sure that they both as a unit, they can afford the property. Then make sure that if one of them leaves, the other can afford the property and properly care of the property. As long as that can happen, if you have two or three applicants at the same time, making sure that if one of them goes away, it's taken care of is the best way to go forward. And our second part of the question is, if an applicant does not have credit, and suspect not legal citizens. So, very good question. Call in VAR as well. But there's a lot of people that don't have credit. Hotline is the best way to talk about if you suspect that they're not legal. But if they don't have credit, there's a myriad of reasons. One, that they might not have ever established it. If you haven't used credit in 4 or 5 years, your credit's gone. So there's a few reasons why they might not have credit. They might be a new citizen, they might be new to the United States, things of that nature. One of those things that you have to have criteria and establish rules for, and then you can go off of that box that you've already found. David, with the changing laws on marijuana to condo, non-smoking rules need to explicitly state marijuana smoking. Is there any recourse if marijuana laws in Arlington? Really good question. As far as I know, it's still a federal offense, and I don't foresee it being a federal offense going away. But yes, each, a lot of jurisdictions are allowing and also just not enforcing. So I would say that if a condo doc has non-smoking to put in their marijuana and or cigarettes and or e-cigarettes would be a really good practice for that condo, and also for a lease, if you're looking at that. I think I saw one more pop in. get them all.
I'm looking.
Debbie?
Yes, I am looking. Let's see. I believe you answered all the questions. I see the last question on my screen is from Anna Marie. Yep. We do have a comment from Diana Flores over here under the Zoom webinar chat. Thank you, Diana, for letting us know that.
Please don't do anything with it more. Yep.
Yeah. Interesting.
So until it's a non-federal offense, I mean, it's stick with it and say, look, it's a federal offense. Some ESA animals come with badges and photos. Yes, that's correct, Nina. A lot of them do come with a badge, a certificate, completion training certificate completion. So, absolutely. Yep. Okay.
Making sure.
Regarding marijuana, what if it's prescribed by Cynthia Medical? Again, that is a very gray area, unfortunately. I can't give you 100% solid answer on that. If it's prescribed and it's medical, and that local jurisdiction is not enforcing it, then it's not going to get enforced. But federal and state level offense, so that could potentially run a risk for that tenant. I apologize. I got a note. My audio is breaking up. I apologize. It came in a little breaky there. I'm scrolling through the questions just to make sure I got them all. Definitely feel free to give us a call. My contact information was on that page, so definitely feel free to give me a call anytime or an email. Happy to have coffee with anybody, have tea with anybody, and answer any other more specific questions at any time. It's absolutely my pleasure.
I see one more, John.
Yep, I just saw that one. How do you handle cosigners? They still have to be screened. They still have to pass the screening and the background credit check, everything of that nature. Their debts and their income are added to the lease, the application. And if they can still be approved, yeah, looks good. Oh, got one popped in on the Q&A board. Gay Ashley asked, a condo, two floors, leak above, whose insurance do you use? Yours. Condo rules are going to be different, so just check with the condo to see if the condo's insurance is going to cover it, or if that specific originating unit's insurance will cover it, or if each unit who's affected, their specific insurance covers it, and then back bills the originating unit's insurance. Be one of those three scenarios, all three, so just check with the condo and see which way they typically have done it, and they'll wait in the right way. An attendee asked, do you have personal properties you manage, and how or what do you cover your bias, your liabilities? Yes, I am an owner and I do manage my own units. I also have properties outside of the area. I don't manage that. I have a property manager for. The way I cover our personal bias is they go through the same screening everybody else goes through. They go through the same process everybody else goes through, and if it's my property specifically, or say it's one of your clients' properties, or it's one of our clients' properties that we manage, there's no difference in screening. There's no difference in anything. So that way there's no bias. And honestly, a lot of times I don't even show those units that I own to help protect against that bias. Can you give an overview of rent forbearance under the new COVID rule? Yes. The new COVID, there is not a forbearance. It's not a forgiving of rent. It is a delay in the ability to file for evictions. For mortgages too, but doesn't mean that the tenant doesn't owe that rent. Good news is we front load a lot of the work, so our rent roll is 99.6% a month. literally a partial payment we're waiting on, because we front load the heavy lifting. But if a tenant hadn't paid, let's say April or May or June, and then July 25th rolls around, they still owe that rent. And at that point, we can start to file legal proceedings, and the owners can start filing legal proceedings. Really not a forbearance or forgiveness. There are a few local jurisdictions, Fairfax and Alexandria, which I know of, did have a program. I believe it was a grant, though, and I don't know if the money's run out, that landlords and tenants could apply for and receive potentially rent, or directly to the tenant or directly to the landlord for assistance. Money's run out. Another question, any known risk of accepting Section 8? Not really any more risk than any other style tenant. Section 8 is just a program that allows the local jurisdiction, the county, to pay part of all or all of the rent for the tenant. There's no real bigger risk or less risk with Section 8 than there is with a regular regular tenant. Cynthia asks, can the landlord ask to see the credit report? If they pull the credit directly, yes, they can look at the credit report. But when we provide our report to landlords, it's not the full credit report. The credit bureaus do not allow us to do third-party sharing. I can't even share the credit report with the tenant, their own credit report. Credit bureau rule. So in short, no, they can't see it unless they have the general rule of thumb. An attendee asks, if you have an 18-year-old tenant, is it advisable to run the credit? Yes, it's actually a requirement. Anybody and everybody that's over the age of 18 must be on the application and must go through the credit reporting and must also be on the lease. That's a rule. We always do it. Frank asks, how do you personally get involved in property management field? Are there any career pathways that potentially lead to property management? Long story, but short story is I look at it as long-term wealth building. Property management, I got into it because I was a landlord and I was doing it for myself for the specific purpose of long-term wealth building. So that's how I got into property management. I did it for myself. Enough people asked me to do it for them, and that's how I got into property management. And I apologize about my audio breaking up. I'm not 100% sure what's going on there. I do have my mic turned all the way up and everything. So I know this is being recorded, and hopefully the recording is getting it a little better than the live, but hopefully that's it. Jorge, have you seen an increase in domestic violence cases in your rental properties? Good news is no. We personally haven't, but I do know on a national level that has gone up. We have had to deal with it in the past. Best practices is to speak directly to the landlord and let them know what's going on. If a restraining order or something like that has been issued and one of them is basically no longer going to be there, really good just to go straight with the landlord and give them blunt truth is the best way to do it with that. It's just to be upfront, completely blunt. Here's what happened. Here's what we have to do to protect the other tenant in this case. You really want to do that. Anna Marie, how can we handle, that one was already answered. What is the most challenging management situation you've ever? That's a good question. Give me a minute to think on that one. I'm going to answer a couple other questions. I'm going to mull over that one. I'll come back to it. Will you accept an agreement to make payments towards the rent not paid during COVID if the tenant cannot afford past rents? Yes, with approval of the landlord, of course. I have no problem doing that if a tenant lost hours or lost employment due to this. Yeah, we will not have any problem working with the tenant. Totally understand this. Let's see if I can get the most challenging property management situation you've ever faced? Was probably, yeah, probably the most challenging property management situation I've ever faced. We were tasked by an owner who had an existing tenant who had a little bit of difficulty in their rent. So we got the management agreement signed, made connection with the tenant, scheduled an inspection to see what we could do and how we can make things work better. The moment we walked into the property, we knew it was a risk for the tenants to continue to live there. This was nothing that the landlord had done themselves. This was unfortunately a case where the tenants had destroyed the property and it had become infected. Unfortunately, we then basically had to tell the tenants that there's really not much we can do here. Our hands are going to unfortunately be tied. We need to talk to the owner. Went back and talked to the owner, explained what was going on. It was such a bad infestation, and there were unfortunately children involved, that it bordered on endangerment, in my personal opinion. Told the landlord to seek an agreeable breaking of the lease because they were already behind a little bit, saying, hey, look, if you can be out by this date, no penalties. Basically, they need to get out of the property for their own safety and for his own safety, as far as being the owner of the property. Once we did get them out and we're starting to get it cleaned, it was... And remember, I always preface this story that I've been in the military and I've seen extremely, extremely poor living conditions. This was by far the worst living condition I've ever seen anywhere on the planet. And this was in Prince William. It was really sad, actually. And I'm glad we got them out. I'm glad we got it fixed and fumigated and no more bugs. But yeah, that was probably one of the worst cases we've ever seen. It probably really was a very difficult, challenging.
Wow.
Jorge, have you seen any template for CARES Act affiliated if they needed to be filled out when you do an UD for a No, we haven't seen an unlawful detainer kind of template for CARES. I don't know of any jurisdictions adding any extra things. For the CARES Act, I do know that like most of the court jurisdictions are closed except for emergency hearings. So, you know, we can't file unlawful detainers. For anybody who doesn't know what a UD is, it's an unlawful detainer. It's the first step of eviction. So we haven't seen any changes in that, but I mean, I wouldn't be so shocked if I saw something. Somebody asked, are there any good books, classes, or YouTube videos that you would recommend? Things like this are probably one of really good resources that you have. Talking to other property managers are a really good thing. There's a few books that I've read. I don't necessarily give any props to anybody, but we'll talk offline about specific books that I've read that help. I mean, the obvious ones, you know, Property Management for Dummies are pretty general. There's a few that I do recommend that I'll feel free to email me or call me offline and we'll talk more specifically about that. How do you handle tours during COVID if the property is occupied? So that is a very good question. What we've done specifically for us is we do not do tours while the home is occupied. It's been a change. Normally we do. So this is an unfortunate fact for the landlords. We wait until it's empty. I don't normally like doing that. I like having 30 to 40 days or so before to market the property, to have a minimal gap. But this case is special. So we wait till the property's vacant, it's been cleaned, and then we do one person at a time. Well, one family, one group at a time. One person at a time. Happy to hand out masks when we do it. We bought a bunch of masks in the beginning. So we'll hand out masks if the applicant wants it. Yeah, that's what we're doing now. We're just waiting for it to be occupied. Best way forward. What are you most proud about having accomplished during your career? Success high points and making you glad you chose this field. Honestly, that would stem from a lot of what the reason why I got into property management. Like I said, I looked at long-term wealth building. So I became a landlord that fed into becoming a property manager for other people. And we've been able to help clients build wealth. One, that's probably one of my most satisfying things about this career field. And two, it's there have been landlords that have been in a bad situation, couldn't sell for various reasons, underwater or other reasons, and needed to rent. And we were able to rent for a while, get them ready to sell. And then when time came, they were able to sell it. Didn't lose money, maybe made a little bit of money. So we really protected a lot of our clients in that sense. The way I look at it, the way we structured the business, we're managing a huge asset for our owner. We want to treat it like a huge asset, and we want to grow that asset, and we want to help make them as financially independent as we can if that's their long-term goal. If they want to rent it for 3 or 4 years and then sell it, that's fine too. We're going to take really good care of it. It's the most satisfying thing about the career. We have taken care of it. We have allowed a lot of our landlords to grow very well because of that. The other thing that a lot of people don't really think about is when you have that tenant that needed, like, give me an example. We have a tenant who is on assistance. They had been turned down several times because they're on assistance, and we're getting a little dismayed with the process. To our landlord, said, "Hey, they're on assistance. Here's the program. We've worked with the program before. It was not fiction. It was a different program. But we've worked with the program before. We like it. We feel comfortable with it. Do you feel comfortable with it?" And they did. So we moved forward with that tenant, and they have been a model tenant, taking perfect care of the home, paid their rent on time, their portion on time. Of course, the assistance has come in properly, and could not have asked for a better tenant. The tenant was a great place, and is a great tenant, and that is from a human standpoint, that's a really good feeling too. Do you use tenant supplied current ledgers or supervisor info and contact? Or do you check another way? What are the questions you ask when speaking? So this is about screening current landlord. When you get an application and you're doing the due diligence of calling landlord and calling the employers. So employers are actually very easy. There's only certain questions an HR department can answer. So that's the easy part. You call their HR department and things go very well. That way, very smooth. Landlords is a little bit more tricky because you're going to call the landlord directly, unless they're with a property management company or an apartment complex. We'll go. That'll be a lot more direct of a Q&A sort of thing. The landlord itself, yeah, call them. How have they been as a tenant? They paid on time? Would you? Yeah. The general questions that you want to get answered, and feel free to be open and honest with them and see how they were as far as tenants goes. And what you're basically trying to do is determine if they're going to make a good tenant for your client. If they've been a past good tenant, they'll probably be a good future tenant. What you're looking to do. NVAR, going back to one of the questions as far as like licenses and classes and designations, I do know that NVAR does have a property management designation, so you can take that. It's a good thing to have. It's a lot of good knowledge, and you can get that designation added to. That helps give, obviously, professionalism, credibility, and other things. Thank you. Somebody said thank you. Answers are good. Great presentation. I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Definitely feel free to keep asking questions away. I'm here all day, as they say, or at least until you're done asking questions.
So did we get them all?
Do you check criminal and terrorists on verification? Yes. So our process for criminal checks is very thorough. I'll see something as minor as a speeding ticket, a serious felony. Yes. Terrorists, that's going to be kind of hard to say if they are or not. If they're not a criminal, I don't really mind it. One of the rules to remember, this is a fairly recent change. You can no longer have a blanket criminal background, but you can't say no felons. Criminal background does have to be case by case. You can demonstrate a danger to the community or to the property. Then you can deny for criminal background. But there's really no danger to the community or the property, or they're going to be have a problem paying their rent or taking care of the property criminal charges, then you can, there's no real big problem with that. The scenario I like to give is if you've got a condo, say it has like a playground and a pool, reasonably assume that there'll probably be kids living in that condo, and if somebody is unfortunately on the offender registry and has to be with, you know, no more than 1,000 feet from children, you could potentially demonstrate a danger to the community. That is a situation that you might be able to deny for on criminal. Again, if you have a question, the NVAR hotline is going to be there and able to answer specific legal questions of this nature. It does have to be case by case. Thank you for your time. Happy to share information again. This is what I do. I'm happy to do it. And voice here for everybody. Email me, call me, absolute pleasure. Cynthia, how do you handle prospective tenants who is a diplomat and has no U.S. credit? That's a really good question. So diplomats do come there, and they typically do make really good tenants. If they don't have any U.S. credit, they'll probably have a letter from their embassy. So just for that, make sure that they're going to take care of the rent is really the big thing, yearly salary. We actually have a embassy that is a tenant of ours, the British Embassy. Rents one of our places for their diplomats. You do it, they're a great tenant. One thing to be aware of, diplomats in particular, if you guys have written many leases, you'll know down near the bottom of the VRL acts if they have a diplomatic immunity. Do, that is a big risk for the landlord, diplomatic immunity. So just be aware of that. Know that if they have it, it is a little bit more risk for the landlord. They actually asked, do you prefer common law or VRLTA and why? Yes, I do prefer VRLTA. The reason is it's better. It gives better protections to the landlords. It gives more strength in if there is a problem, an eviction. You're able to recoup more, and you're able to interest fees, things of that nature. NVR Act is a really good versus common law versus VRLTA breakdown on their website. If you go to the website and look it up, it's really good. It explains the differences. And you can see that VRLTA has more protections in general for the landlord. And that's typically who the client is in these sort of things. So you want to protect them as much as you can. The reason we also specifically use the VRLTA is every 6 months it's reviewed by the state legislator and updated accordingly. So we know it's the most up-to-date lease that there is. It applies to all the little rules and laws that might have been tweaked over the year. So you know there's no question of ambiguity with this lease. The other reason we like it is, unfortunately, when you do have to go to court, you do have to bring a copy of your lease. Personal experiences, the judge looks down, sees VRLTA, knows exactly what's in it. There's no questions about the lease. It's a much smoother process. So again, it's just better for the landlord. Jorge, I am not sure, but looks like after July 1, we may have income source fair housing. Yes. Jorge is asking about a change in source of income protection. Yes, that's correct. It is going to de facto protect Section 8. So yeah, be aware of that change. I know NVAR has some really good talks and presentations on it. It's definitely changing. So the source of income is going to be a protected class, and that means Section 8. You can no longer just say, we no longer accept Section 8 because we don't accept Section 8. 8. You have to screen a Section 8 tenant just like any other tenant and let the landlord know they're on Section 8. But that doesn't mean that the other rules still don't apply as far as credit, as far as income, as far as criminal background, landlord reference, but all those still apply. Just can't say, no, we don't take Section 8 because we don't take it. I did not catch that again in VL. I apologize. Eva Chen, I'm not 100% sure which one you're referring to there. So if you could just ask that question again, I'll definitely readdress what you missed. Anna Marie, what is the minimum credit score? So that's going to be dependent upon the landlord. We have a minimum, and it's our standard. We force it across the board, but that's going to be landlord dependent, and also property management company dependent. So whatever that rule is you establish, stick to it and go forward and be great. Please restate the response on diplomatic immunity. Okay, so yeah, diplomats that have diplomatic immunity are immune from evictions. That's considered a civil proceeding, not a criminal proceeding. Most diplomats that have diplomatic immunity have civil immunity. So they can't be evicted in that sense. There are other ways to lean on them, State Department, things of that nature, but that's a much longer process. So if you are approving a diplomat that has diplomatic immunity, just be aware of it, inform your landlord, and let them know that that could be a problem. Don't think it will be, but just be aware. That is not one of the protected or clauses. So if that's too much of a risk for your landlord, that's a risk for your landlord. Eva Chen, some forms lease give better protections. Yes. So the better protection lease is the VRLTA for landlords, absolutely. So Anna Marie, don't be offended, but can landlord decline military since they can exit easily and leave the landlord mid-lease and stuck? Really good question. I do not believe military is any way covered or any protected or sort of thing. However, like we said earlier, source of income will be. So I could see a potential workaround there where they say, well, our source of income is the military. You're denying me because of source of income. I understand what you're saying, and you're absolutely right. Military could get orders. There's just nothing you can do about it. The other thing to remember is active duty only makes up about 20-25% of the force. 80-75% is reserves, and they can get orders at any time. So it's a risk. It's part of it. We've never had military tenant, now that I think about it, mid-lease, leave. We've had tenants asked to stay for an additional month or two while their orders were finalized, but I've never had a military tenant mid-lease leave. And it does happen. I'm not saying it doesn't, but I've just never personally had it. If it does happen, you got to let them go. That is true. That is very true. Does Section 8 require third-party inspection and landlord to comply? What aspects of Section 8 is a risk or hassle? So yes, Section 8 does their own inspection, and they do require certain things. One of the more nitpicky things, if you will, is they require screens in every window that can open. So might seem like a minor thing, but it's what they require. Of course, there's other things that are much, much more specific to security. They look at everything. They say, we're happy to write to you. Yes. Yeah, there is a third-party inspection with that. I don't necessarily view them as a hassle or any risk when they're doing their inspection, because their inspection is really designed to find a good home and a good place for that tenant to live. So no real risk with that, no real hassle, because like I said in the beginning, a lot of our landlords do want to provide a really good home to the tenants. So when Section 8 comes and says, hey, will you fix X? I have no problem fixing X.
John?
Yes, reminded that NVIDIA has a great resource for vendors to specifically go on to if something has to be fixed, let's say by Section 8, and you don't know who to use. NVIDIA has a great resource for vendors, and I know we sent out all these vendors have been approved. Well, I won't say approved, vetted by NVIDIA, and they really do like them. So use that resource. Use NVIDIA resources. This is going to be helpful to you. Question. Tenant isn't paying. Do you contact an attorney, handle it yourself in filing for eviction? As a property manager, our specific property management agreement gives us the ability to enforce the lease. So we can handle it personally. Never a bad idea to get an attorney involved, though, because you want to make sure you do it properly. So if you have questions, definitely reach out to the attorney. Make sure you're doing it right. Some of the initial filing paperwork in the beginning really can be handled by anybody, but once things go in front of courts, probably a good idea to have the attorney there. Yeah. If the tenant breaks a window, but claim it was stuck and it just cracked when they opened, how do you resolve that? Good question. And this can go on to almost any other break or damage that could potentially be caused by a tenant. There's a certain amount of risk that a landlord takes in having a tenant in his property or her property. These things are never really provable. Oh, a rock hit it from outside, or this happened. They're very, very rarely provable 100% fault of the tenant. If it's very clear, very obvious, sure, you can backbill a tenant. But if it's not, our personal suggestion to the landlord would be to go ahead and fix it and go, hey, be much more careful, because this is kind of the one time we'll let this go. Don't burn any bridges if you don't have the very beginning. Okay, Ashley, thank you very much. My pleasure again. Always my pleasure. Always my pleasure. Landlord, tenant, folks contact you. Any advice? Do they provide resolution or just mediation? I think you're talking mediation in the court or potentially working it out between a tenant and a landlord, say where the tenant has stopped paying. So if a landlord contacts us and they're having trouble with their tenant, we're happy to help any way we can. A lot of times when we do get involved as a professional company, logo on the paperwork and everything of that nature, it does encourage the tenant to treat it much more serious, because now there's a professional involved. Not just, oh, it's my landlord. No, there's now a company involved. And insured, and you know, those sort of things kind of trigger a certain mental trigger in the tenant. So that helps a lot of times. Other times, we just do what we got to do and start filing the paperwork and go forward. Or if there's a mediation process in the court, never against trying to mediate. Personal experiences might work 50-50. So if you actually do end up having to evict and having to go mediate in court, and you do go to mediation, you do make this agreement, what you've done is you said, we agree to make this agreement in lieu of eviction. So if the tenant does not then live up to that agreement, you just evict them. Never a bad idea to work it out. But a lot of times, once you go to court, you've tried all these things. So completely up to the landlord. We personally don't recommend mediation because we've done everything we can do. One of the things that PMI is going to roll out in 2021, something called PMI Cares. This is a 531c3 where we allow tenants who have fallen on a hardship be given grants for their rent. So we're going to be doing everything we can to make sure that the tenants are paid. Or sorry, the landlord who paid the rent, and that the tenants are made capable of paying the rent. But at the end of the day, if it doesn't happen, we have to go to the court and get that landlord paid. Bonnie, how do you prospect find new business? Believe it or not, Most of our business is referrals. We do have some paid advertisement, absolutely. Most of our business is referrals because we do things like this. We talk to agents, we do information. We are happy to answer questions like this and be a really good tool for agents. And that's where we get most of our business. And we're happy and we're glad of it. Let's see some questions. I don't see anything else.
I think we got them. So I wanted to remind everybody, or to just let you all know, there is a fabulous resource on the NAR website. It is the Property Management Network, and it focuses on negotiation strategies and tactics, networking, referrals, business planning, systems, personal performance management, and leadership development, and the NAR designation. So if you get a chance, visit the website. Great information. Okay, John, thank you all for attending today. And John, thanks again. That was a fantastic presentation. And I also wanted to tell you, thank you so much for your service as a veteran.
Pleasure.
I appreciate it. And if you have any further questions that we were not able to answer, please email webmaster@ndar.com and we will do our best to get right back to you. And I wanted to leave you with some final announcements and upcoming events before we call it a day. And I would like to thank Gina Myers and Patrick Connors and the entire NDAR staff for making this webinar possible. Thank you guys. They worked so hard for us members and we appreciate you. I wanted to remind you all that NVAR COVID-19 information can be found online at www.nvar.com/open for business. I also wanted to, if you've seen the emails go out from NVAR, we have hub lockers, which are available 24/7 for pickup. So if you need anything from the realtor store, go online and order, and you can pick it up right there at the hub lockers. It's really cool. I went there yesterday and picked up a mask. So I'm all set. I also wanted to remind you the next small broker event, Getting to a Prosperous Future, will be held on June 25th at 11 a.m. The new member advisory group is hosting a webinar, Building Extraordinary Relationships During a Global Pandemic, and that is on June 4th at 2 p.m. And the Realtor Builder Forum will be holding a virtual small home tour on June 12th with alarm.com. And registration for all these events are free and located at the nvar.com event calendar. And again, I just want to thank everybody for participating today. Great questions, John. Amazing presentation. Very grateful. And you all, I wish you a very happy Memorial Day weekend. Have fun. Be safe.
Thank you.
All right. Bye, guys.